Praise the Lord. All right, so we've been doing a series on the book of, the book of Revelation. It's really been in a study of the end times. Amen. The theological word is eschatology or end time events. Tonight, we're mostly really coming out of the book of Revelation. We spent a lot of time talking about the Antichrist. During that time frame, we've talked about the Antichrist. We've talked about the false prophet. One of the main things that we spoke about the Antichrist was we determined from the scriptures that the Antichrist is going to be a world leader and that ultimately he will be possessed by Satan himself. There was one other person that we know according to the scriptures that was possessed by Satan. The Word of God says that Judas Iscariot, that the devil entered into him. And so the similar thing is going to happen whenever the Antichrist takes his rule. And I believe that there will be an actual counterfeit resurrection, that he will die of a mortal head wound and he will resurrect a counterfeit resurrection, because he counterfeits everything that that God has done in his plan, if you will. Well, tonight we're going to talk specifically about the mark of the beast. Now, I have to tell you, and I don't know if it's a warning, but I just want to give a disclaimer. I'm going to use a lot of scripture on the front end of the teaching. At the same time, I guess about 3.5 years ago, my whole ministry or my whole way of thinking and everything really took a major shift whenever the Lord began to put on my heart to start studying or researching the occult. So I guess I would tell you that not only do I desire to be an avid Bible student, amen, and what I mean is to be a learner of the Bible, to be a studier of the scriptures, but I guess I would call myself also an occult researcher, at least to dig into and to find out. But everything that I do is always connected back to the scriptures and a desire to find out how does this. And let me tell you, by doing that, I don't mean to go on any rabbit trails because I want to try to be careful of my time. But by doing that, my eyes were opened to other levels of the scripture that I was blinded to before. What I mean by that is that the way that the occult world accesses their demon spirits in order to gain wisdom and knowledge from the spiritual realm, as I began to study that, and then I went back to the scriptures, I realized that these were the very things and practices that were taking place in the land of Canaan. If you'll remember, I have a hard time not writing on the board. Can y'all see back there? Even though it's a little dark?
Yeah.
All right. The land of Canaan is now known as Israel, and it was this area between the Jordan River and the Mediterranean Sea. And all in this area of Canaan, which is this strip now that we call Israel, which was promised to Abraham that God would give it to Abraham, amen, after the 400 years of captivity in Egypt, and as they began to come out, the Lord began to speak to Moses and the children of Israel, and he spoke to them in the book of Leviticus, specifically, if I'm not mistaken, chapter 17, 18, and 19, and he told them, whenever you go into the land, you're not to engage in the practices that the inhabitants of the land have engaged in, for they have polluted the land. And when you begin to look at the various things that they engaged in and had all to do with, that's where the man lying with man. I mean, listen, they can say whatever they want to say. The Supreme Court, I've said it before, the Supreme Court can change whatever they want to try to change. The Word of God is never changing. God's heart is never changing. And I'm not trying to say, let me be clear on this, that every homosexual, whether they be, a man or a woman or whatever the case, is automatically aware of the fact that they're engaging in occult practices. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that the occult engages in those behaviors, and whenever they're doing it specifically in order to engage demon spirits. And so it was man not lying with man, woman not lying with woman, bestiality, all those kinds of things, drinking blood, all types of sorcery and magic and various things that were happening that was going on in the land of Canaan, where God told his children Israel, you're about to go into the land and you're not to do what the inhabitants of that land are doing. And lo and behold, modern day occultists and somebody like Aleister Crowley would actually take of those secrets that had been taught. Listen, whenever you go back and you study that, you begin to look whenever Israel actually enters into the promised land to engage the battle of the giants, you begin to realize that, listen, these Nephilim, we haven't talked about that in quite a while, and I have to be careful that we don't get into all that right now, but the Bible says there were giants in the land in those days, before the flood and after the flood. And these giants, they just weren't large and tall in stature, but that they were really a hybrid being of fallen angel and human being. That's what the scripture says. I can prove it from the scriptures. I'm telling you that right now. This is the first time you heard it. Listen, I've been looked at and frowned upon by many a people. Oh, you're teaching things that are going to cause confusion. You're going to cause people, listen to me, you want to talk confusion, I'll tell you confusion whenever chaos begins to hit this earth. And God help us if the truth of the matter is that the rapture hadn't taken place and America sees some crazy things happening. That's confusion. It's better that we understand and know that we have a formidable foe, and that we're in the midst of a battle, and that the evil that's been lurking for centuries or thousands of millennia is still alive and well today and moving and operating in the midst of human lives and in an attempt to take over this world. It's not just happening at the end, it's been happening. And so I just want you to know that these occult practices, and so I went off on a rabbit trail to say, based off of the fact that I call myself an occult researcher. I want to research, okay? I want to know some things, but I want to connect things back to the Bible. So tonight's teaching is going to be a little bit different. We're going to talk about the mark of the beast, and I have to tell you that some of the things that I'm going to talk to you about, I can't prove to you that this is the way that it's going to go down. I can't. It's not my job to prove anything to you. It's something that I know that there's some things going on. I've seen evidences of it. I've done a lot of research on it. And so tonight, this is what I feel like. We're going to talk about scripture, but we're also going to talk about some things that have happened already and things that are going on right now, and try to connect it to what a possibility could be regarding the mark of the beast. Is everybody clear on that? I want everybody to be clear that the preacher's not saying that this is exactly how the mark of the beast is going down, okay? But I do want you to be aware that there's a lot of things that are happening right now and that this could be part of it. So let's start off with some scripture right here. I got Revelation chapter 14, verse 1, and Revelation 13, 16, and I have them side by side. And the reason that I did that was because I just thought it was interesting that in Revelation 14, 1, it says, "And I looked, And lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads." Now, you know, this is talking specifically, if we went back to Revelation 7, it talks about that there were 144,000 Jews, 12,000 from each of the tribes, that were sealed with the father's seal on their forehead. You know, the same word for sealed there is the same word that's used in Ephesians 1:13. I use that scripture a lot whenever I preach, because I try to tell people that that's how you really know when you're saved. This is how you really know you're saved. When you get saved, when you accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit comes into your heart and you get sealed with the Holy Spirit. Same word sealed in Revelation 7 regarding these 144,000 is the same word spoken of in Ephesians 1:13. And the idea of the seal has to do with security, and it has to do with protection. Truth be told, that you being sealed by the Holy Spirit, you have protection. Fact of the matter is, though, at least according to my understanding of the scripture, just because you're sealed with the Holy Spirit doesn't mean that you cannot fall away from the Lord. Nevertheless, in this end times situation, these people are sealed with this mark from the Father to protect them as they preach the gospel during this time frame of the Great Tribulation. Now, next to it, because you remember how I told you before we even got started good, that the enemy counterfeits everything that God desires to do. And so it says in Revelation 13, 16, "And he causeth," talking about the Antichrist, "all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads." All right. So now we're going to use our Bibles and we're going to go through. I have several different scriptures right here that speak specifically about the mark of the beast. Revelation 13, 16. This is 13, 16 through 18. We'll just read all three of those verses now. Same, starting off at 16. "He causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads." Why? Verse 17. "And that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name." One of the things that I don't think I ever really noticed as much before as I've noticed it as I've been studying this, is the close connection between the mark of the beast and the worship of the image of the beast, or the worship of the beast himself. As we move forward in the scriptures, you're going to see that whenever people are being tormented forever and eternity, that there's a connection between those two concepts. They worship the beast. They worship the image of the beast, but they also had the mark of the beast. And so, Now, I wanted to just point out, you know, because I think about these things whenever I'm reading them and studying them. This isn't just like some little glow stamp thing that you got whenever you used to go to the club or whatever, whenever you used to hang out or wherever you used to get your little stamp, you know, and they'd run it under that little fluorescent, that black light, and you're like, okay, you paid your dues, you can come in. This is going to be something that's, yeah, it's going to be, obviously it's going to be permanent, but it's going to be, there's going to be a lot more to it. Because the truth is that if it was just some little stamp, then everybody could be going around. I'm just trying to make a point. In some way, shape, or form, this thing's going to become part of who you are. You understand what I'm getting at? Because if not, then the teller behind the at the grocery store could say, we could be winking at each other like, yeah, we got the stamp, dude. It's all good. You know what I'm saying? But we know that we haven't sold ourselves out. No, in some way, shape, or form, this thing is going to become part of who you are, and there's not going to be you're not going to be able to get away with it. Like, in other words, everything's going to be integrated. And the technology that we have now in society, I'm going to show you a little bit of some of the things that are going on, will allow that to actually take place. And listen, I'm just going to share with you some of the things that were broadcast in the news. And actually, you can just easily find. So if they're telling us they can do these things, I'm telling you right now, there's a whole lot more technology out there that's much greater than what they're leading on to us to see. All right? And so it says right here, or the number of his name, verse 18, here is wisdom, let him that has understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. So a score is 20 in King James English. So 60 is 60, so the number 666. And you know, many people have, listen, there's a form of interpretation called gematria, and both Hebrew and Greek languages have numbers assigned to each number, and there's databases, and people have computer programs, and they'll run names through these things, and you'll come up with names like Barack Obama or Hitler, and it all works, you know. It keeps bumping up that it tells you 666, these numbers are in there within their name. And you know, that's all fine and dandy, but the truth of the matter is that, I'll be honest with you, Hitler wasn't the Antichrist, and I don't think Obama's the Antichrist. There's a whole lot of people that are sold out on that. I'm not saying he's not a type of the Antichrist. I'm not saying, the Word of God says there's a spirit of Antichrist. We studied this, and we taught this ad nauseum, that there's a spirit of Antichrist, meaning just as the Holy Spirit is moving upon the earth and drawing people to Jesus, there's also a spirit of Antichrist that's moving humanity in a certain direction in opposition and rebellion against God. The Word of God's clear of that. First John says that there's a spirit of Antichrist. The Word of God says in Ephesians chapter 2 that there's a spirit that works in the children of disobedience. And so what I need you to know is that, yeah, Barack Obama may be a type of the Antichrist, but you're not going to convince me that he's the one. All right. And so anyway, but it is the number of man. The number 6 is the number that the day that man was created on the 6th day. The number 6 is always typically associated with mankind. And one of the things that jumps out to me is this, is that the enemy of our soul is using humanity just as God desires to use you and I in order to move his plan forward. The enemy of our soul is also using man to move his plan forward. I'm going to show you a little bit tonight that might surprise some of you, but showing, you know, to move his plan forward, he's using humanity just like God uses humanity. And the fact of the matter is that this is also a form of a false trinity, if you will. There's a false prophet, he's a man. There's a beast, he's a man, a world leader, a religious person. And then ultimately, there's also going to be the image of the beast. And all this, they receive their power from the dragon. Okay? And so, let's see here. Revelation 14, verses 9 through 11. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worships the beast in his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast in his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Now, you know, this has... Look at verse 12. I'm going to come back to this verse, by the way, because I want to talk about this a little bit more. Look at verse 12. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Now, we already talked about this to some extent, but I told you that that word for saints there in the Greek is hagios. I don't know if you remember that or not. That word hagios is, it means separated out. It means to be made holy. So I don't know exactly who the saints are at this point. It could be a couple of different people. It could be part of these 144,000 Jews. It could be Jewish people, because the word saint is used for the Jewish people in the Old Testament. It could be people that were believers that were left behind that now have been awakened. And have, or people that weren't even believers. And because listen, this is the truth. You're either justified or you're not. Well, you're either a believer or you're not. You're either in Christ or you're not. And we don't have time to get into all that. But you're either righteous by the blood of the Lamb or you're not. Okay? Now, but at the same time, there's many people that have heard the gospel but rejected the gospel. Well, whenever pandemonium strikes and the rapture does take place and people are left behind and fear grips their heart, believe me, there's going to be some people that are going to be like, my grandma told me this was going to happen, and she told me, don't, whatever you do, boy, don't worship the image of that beast, and whatever you do, don't take that mark in your right hand or your forehead. And so there's going to be saints that are going to be getting saved on the earth during that time frame. And what it says in this scripture right here is that it talks about first the terror and the torment of those that have received the mark, but then it says, and this is the patience of the saints. And so there's some people that are enduring this, that are holding on to Jesus in the midst of it all. Whatever your theological persuasion is, what do you mean by that, preacher? Because some people don't believe in a pre-tribulation rapture. And you can call them a heretic if you want, but the fact of the matter is they got some smart people that believed in a mid-trib rapture. I'm talking smart, that studied the scriptures and loved Jesus. They got some people that don't believe in a rapture, at least they believe in a post-tribulation rapture. What we're trying to do here is we're just trying to get into the Word of God, and we're trying to let the Word of God speak and prepare our hearts and minds to be sober-minded and to be aware, hey, preach the gospel, amen, till Jesus comes back. But One thing that hits me when I see this, and it wasn't really in my notes, but look, I mean, I know that my family members don't really watch the videos, but I had a family member that married a Jehovah's Witness. And I'm going to tell you right now, I spent weeks meeting with one of the elders of their church with their Bible and studying their scriptures. And the reason I bring that up is because they don't believe in hell. And it's clear right here that something's going on. It says right here that those that receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. Look at this. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. They have no rest day nor night. The scripture's clear. There's a hell. There's a hell to shun. And listen, this isn't the only one. Jesus taught on it. I don't mean to twist off and go into all of that, but I'm going to tell you right now, Lord, look, I love to talk to them people, and I thank the Lord that but they don't ever really want to talk about it. When you sit down and you start bringing it up, it's like, oh, somebody that knows the Bible, we got to go. And I'm telling you right now, oh, Lord, help me. I get so angry whenever I start thinking about it. Because every time they think they have an argument and you bring out the truth, the next thing you know, they run. And they don't want to stay around and talk about it. Anyway, that's another story for another time. Revelation chapter 15, verse 2. It says, and I saw, as it were, a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark. And they overcame... over the number of his name, stand upon the sea of glass, having the harps of God, and they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, the song of the Lamb, saying, "Great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty, just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints." So, in the interpretation that I receive from this scripture is that they endured. Whoever these saints are that are on this sea of glass and they're singing this song, they've endured. They did not succumb to the lies of this system that tried to get everyone to take this mark, but instead they endured and they persevered and they came off victorious. And there's a victory song that they're singing. I was so intrigued, I had to go back and I had this, man, I got to find this song of Moses. So I think it's right, it's got to be in Exodus 15. If you turn with me to Exodus 15, it's a beautiful song. After the children of Israel were delivered through on dry ground, Exodus chapter 15. And it works perfect for the scenario that we're talking about in the book of Revelation. Because it's a song of deliverance. Yeah. It's a song of victory. It says right here in chapter 15, verse 1, "Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spoke, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea." Now, you know, that may not ring true to you, but if you've done any studying of the book of Revelation, and I've already mentioned it a couple of times, and we're going to probably maybe even start delving into that next week with the seals. But in Revelation 6, verse 2, it talks about a rider on a horse. And he's the counterfeit Christ. He's the Antichrist. And I just love the fact that this song way back in the book of Exodus, and we're being told in the book of Revelation that they sang the song of Moses. And so I got to tell you that I just got really excited when I began to read this song and to see that the horse and his rider has been thrown into the sea. "The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will prepare him a habitation. My father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name." You know, you and I have no fight against the forces of evil. You and I have no chance to stand against an Antichrist system. But listen, as small as the fledgling church was with the original disciples that stood against the mighty Roman Empire and began to flourish during those times and even found their blood being shed, and it was almost like fertilizer in the soil causing the church to grow exponentially. In the same way, the same grace that was with them, amen, will be with those people in the end days, and he's going to be with us right now if trial and tragedy starts to strike. I'm telling you right now, it's not that far away where all that stuff's going on in the Middle East, folks. Come on, somebody, help me out. Am I telling you the truth or not? It's not that far away. As a matter of fact, it's here. Didn't they kill some Marines a couple of weeks back? Yeah, they did. ISIS took credit for it. So what I'm trying to tell you is, don't tell me that terror can't strike American soil. I know this isn't how you build a church. Everybody wants to hear happy stuff. Tell me happy stuff, preacher. Tell me words that are going to comfort me and encourage. Well, it is going to comfort you and encourage you. You know how? Because the same Jesus that got Paul through is going to get you through. Amen? The same grace that was purchased by the blood of the Lamb that gives you access to grace and puts peace on the inside of your heart, even when you're sitting in the Mamertine prison about to have your head chopped off, is the same grace that can be with you and I today, no matter what it is that we face. Man, we got to face the truth. We got to see the reality of it, and we got to be willing to preach it, whether people like it or not. We're not here to build numbers. We're here to build disciples. That's what we're in the business of. And that's what we're going to do by the grace of God. As long as I got breath in my lungs and his grace is still flowing in my life, we're going to tell the truth. Amen? All right. And so it says right here, Pharaoh's chariots, verse 4, and his host, that's talking about his army, had he cast into the sea. His chosen captains also are drowned in the Red Sea. You know, whenever we taught on the Antichrist, we taught on types of the Antichrist. And one type of the Antichrist is Pharaoh. I don't know if y'all remember that, but we have a series on it. Y'all can go back and watch it. Pharaoh was a type of the Antichrist. He's wanting to subjugate or hold God's people down under his dominion. And he doesn't want to allow them to worship God. He won't let them go into the wilderness to worship God. And finally, God has to break his back to deliver his people. Amen? Through the blood of a lamb. Hallelujah. And it goes on to say, verse 5, the depths have covered them. They sank into the bottom of it as a stone. Thy right hand, O Lord. you know, that really stuck out to me today. Thy right hand, O Lord, has become glorious in power. Thy right hand, O Lord, has dashed in pieces the enemy. As a matter of fact, I'm going to stop in the Song of Moses right there. And I just wanted to point something out because I told you that I was going to talk to you a little bit about the occult tonight. And because of that, that kind of stuck out to me. You see, the right hand of the Lord, you see that terminology used a lot in the scriptures. And the right hand of the Lord, the right hand, describes God's power. If you study anything having to do with the occult, one of the things that you'll learn is they call it the left-hand path. They call it the left-hand path because they're talking about the occult power. It's the opposite of the right hand. As a matter of fact, whenever they throw their little voodoo signs or whatever the case, they'll oftentimes purposefully use their left hand. Much research that I've done shows that there's a lot of... And listen, you got to understand something. We're not talking about some witch that's living on Bourbon Street or, you know, tucked away in an alley on Bourbon Street. We're talking about some of the most powerful people in the world. You understand what I'm saying? That are practicing this stuff. And yeah, they might learn from somebody like Marie Laveau would have been in order to gain their power and everything like that. But they're taking it and they're mixing it with government. They're taking it and they're mixing it with music. They're taking it and they're mixing it with movies. And they are, through all of this multimedia process, trying the best they can. And we're going to talk a little bit about that tonight. Brainwash society.
Yes.
And they call it the left-hand path. And they feel like there's power in the left hand. And so what I was going to tell you is that there's a lot of wealthy people that own graveyards from some of the research that I did. And it's an amazing thing that they find skulls and skull. Every now and then they'll exhume a body for whatever the reason. And lo and behold, there's a left hand missing and a skull missing. And what it is that they went in there beforehand and they took these things because they believe that there's power in these things. And I just wanted to point out to you that the right hand in the scripture speaks of the hand of God, the powerful hand of God, but the opposite in the occult world is it talks about the left hand path, okay? And so anyway, we're going to talk a little bit about skulls tonight just for a second, but all right, let's go to Revelation 15:2. No, we're going to Revelation 16:2. It says in Revelation 16, let's start at verse 1. And I heard a great voice out of the temple saying to the seven angels, go your ways and pour out the vials of the wrath of God upon the earth. And the first went and poured out his vial upon the earth. And there fell a noisome and grievous sore upon the men which had the mark of the beast and upon them which worshipped his image. And you know, I don't know that this is really the scripture right here, but there's another spot where it talks about this sore being poured upon mankind, those that are guilty of this mark and everything. And it says that, and they repent not. It's like no matter what is happening to them, and this is something that really stuck out in my heart during this week as I've been pondering this. And it's really kind of what led to some of this thought that the way that I prepared this message. No matter what happens to them, they don't repent. It's like the torment of their smoke, it's an eternal wrath that they're going to endure, but no matter what happens, they don't repent. And to me, that says something to me. And the reason that I say that is because God is merciful. You understand what I'm saying? God is merciful. You think there's never been a Satanist that didn't repent? Of course there's been Satanists that have repented. Yes. And you think that there's never been somebody that didn't practice black magic that didn't repent? I mean, I thank God one time, I'm kind of embarrassed to admit it, but one time I was with this little dude that was practicing black magic, and I told him this thing that I wanted, and he said, oh, we can work you up a little something on that. And he did. I've never told this story to too many people, but he wrote up a little spell thing, and he had his incense that he was burning. And I'm not going to tell you really what the story was, but to some extent, what he did, it actually... it didn't happen the way that I was really wanting it to happen, but something happened to the very in the very situation that I and to be honest with you, I didn't think a whole lot about it. I know that I got goosebumps thinking about the EBGBs. I know that the Lord protected me because I realized now what it was. It was a little bit of a tease. It was a little bit of an open door to try to get me to come back in deeper. You understand what I'm saying? To try to practice those arts more. to try to go a little bit deeper into the arts of black magic to say, okay, if this little thing right here will get you that, if you go a little bit deeper, then I can give you this. And anyway, I thank the Lord that that didn't happen. But I just, you know, I'm just saying that there's power in all of that. And so anyway, let's go to Revelation chapter 19, verse 20. I tried to be transparent up here as much as I can, but I don't think I've ever told that story before. Revelation 19, verse 20. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into a lake of fire burning with brimstone, and the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceeded out of his mouth, and all the fowls were filled with their flesh. So this is the battle of Armageddon, and Jesus has come now, and he's destroying the beast and the false prophet, and he's throwing them into what's called the lake of fire. And that word is translated as Gehenna. And I don't know, I guess maybe it's in my head now because I mentioned it earlier, but that's a big argument of the Jehovah's Witnesses right there is that the word Gehenna that Jesus was talking about, this place called the Valley of Hinnom. The Valley of Hinnom was south of Jerusalem. And it was a place, it was a valley. And it was called the Valley of Hinnom, and it was a place where they put all their refuse. So dead bodies would go there, garbage would go there, and they would burn it. And so there was a constant burning in the smell of flesh. There was also a time frame during Israel's history that they caused their children to walk through the fire to Molech there. And so it was a very bad place in the eyes of Israel. Whenever Jesus came through and he was talking about the lake, he was talking about fire, right? And he was talking about where the worm doesn't die and that there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. That's what he was talking about. The word there is Gehenna, G-E-H-E-N-N-A, and it's a translation. It's translated out as the Valley of Hinnom. And so what the Jehovah's Witnesses do is that they twist that and they say, well, he was talking about a literal place called the Valley. Yeah, he was talking about a literal place. He was giving them a visual picture of what hell's going to be like. It's going to be burning, and there's going to be flesh burning, and the worm's not going to die, and there's going to be weeping, and there's going to be gnashing of teeth, and the torment, the smoke of their torment rises day after day after day. And whenever I told that man that, I'm telling you, he got so angry with me on that day. I said, sir, this is the problem. You're preaching another Jesus. Oh, look, he loved me before that. But when I told him that was at the end of 3 weeks. I said, no, sir, you're preaching another Jesus. And I said, you don't even believe in a hell. And I got to tell you something, sir. If you don't get a hold of the right Jesus, you're going to believe in it soon. He said, oh, you're preaching the doctrine of devils. I said, no, sir, why would the devil want me to believe that there is a hell? Wouldn't the devil want you to believe that there's not a hell so that you just believe? You understand what I'm saying? Listen, Lord, help us. The smoke of their torment rises day and night. All right, so Revelation chapter 20, verse 4. So Gehenna, the lake of fire, gets its name from the Valley of Hinnom. That's what Jesus was talking about, but there's a literal lake of fire where the false prophet... So, I mean, what are you going to do with that, sir? The false prophet, you think he's going to throw him in the physical valley that's south of Jerusalem? Come on, man. No. They're going to be thrown in this place, and then after that, there's coming a day when the dragon gets thrown in here too, and we'll teach that as we move forward. Revelation chapter 20, verse 4. And I saw thrones, and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them, and I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Hallelujah. The millennial reign of Christ. Boy, that's going to be good right there. Amen. All right. So I wanted to go back just real quick to that Revelation 14:11, where it talks about in the smoke of their torment ascends up forever and ever. They have no rest day nor night who worship the beast in his image and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. I kept having it ringing in my spirit that there's no turning back for these people. You know, it actually, if you go back and you read all of the whole thing, starting in verse 9, if any man worships the beast, this is Revelation 14:9, If any man worships the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God. There's no turning back. Once you take this mark, whatever this mark is, I believe, this is just my opinion, something happens to you. Yes, I understand something happens to you spiritually whenever you give your soul to Satan. I get that. But it's like there's no turning back on this. And the only point that I'm trying to make is that in the past, whenever people have turned their life over to the enemy, there was still the chance that they could hear the gospel and bow their knee and give their heart to the Lord. It seems as though something is happening here that does not allow them to do that. You understand what I'm getting at? Once again, this is somewhat speculation. I can't prove it. But what I do want to say is I believe something's going to happen to people's brains. I believe in some way, shape, or form, something's going to happen to the inside of the man, whatever it is, the inside of the man or the woman, that's going to either sear the conscience, that's going to cause something to happen to them to where they can no longer hear the gospel. Because listen, during this time frame, it says that there's angels flying in the sky preaching the eternal gospel. The gospel's still being preached. There's still believers on the land. People are being told God's pouring his wrath out on the earth. These people are being stricken with sores and boils, and they're still not repenting. It says they repenteth not. And so something has to happen, a searing to their consciousness. I mean, they're seeing what's happening to them. They see their own flesh. They see that they're not really going to win, but at the same time, they just move forward with their deception. And you know, some of the things that I'm gonna open up here in a minute, once again, I want to make it clear, I don't know that this is how it goes down, but I personally believe, and or at least I wonder, is something going to happen to the brain? To where it can no longer, is there a part of the brain in the cerebral cortex or the higher levels of intelligent learning that actually can look and ponder and see, you know, God is real? Have you ever asked that question? I mean, before you really gave your heart to the Lord. I can remember driving and thinking to myself, there's got to be more to this. There's got to be more to this. And I just believe that at some point in time, these people, they whatever this mark does, it does something to them. Well, I just want to introduce you to this concept. This is a guy named Proteus. He was a mythological god. You can see if you look at his legs that he's got goated type legs, and he's got like a serpent's tail. He's got the Triton pitchfork. Proteus, this is the Marvel Comics version of Proteus. Proteus, I think if I'm not mistaken, was an X-Man, and I don't know, he wasn't. I'm looking over there at my kids because one of them's an X-Men. Anyway, according to the research I did, Proteus was one of these, and this is the thing that Proteus was famous for. He was a shapeshifter, but he could possess the host. Now why are you talking about comic books? Why are you talking about ancient mythological gods? Okay, I'm going to tell you why. Because ancient mythological gods were fallen angels and demon spirits that were being worshipped by people, okay? Not only that, the reason I'm going to tell you is because I'm about to connect the name Proteus to a modern company, and I want to show you what they're doing today. But what I want you to see before we do that is, and what I want to tell you is that I have documented proof, I got books in my library back there, that will tell you that occultists, and even the highest level of occultists, Satanists if you will, have taught people through the ages that they communicate with symbolism. And that the people that they communicate to through symbolism know what they're talking about, but people like you and I, we're clueless. They call us goyim, or like little cattle, and now we don't know anything because they say we're uninitiated. So the occultists, see, to be born again means you give your heart to Jesus, and when you do, what happens? The light comes on, amen? Hallelujah, the good news about Jesus Christ floods your soul, and the light comes on, and now your eyes are open to the things of God. Well, they say that they get a light too. They say that Lucifer, the bearer of light, gives them light. They call it the initiation. And whenever they do, that's how they speak. They speak in lies. It's actually a noble thing for them to lie. They look at it as the most beautiful thing that you could ever see. God operates in truth. the enemy operates in lies. And God operates in light, the enemy operates in darkness. So I just wanted you to see, that's the reason that I'm bringing this up, because I want to show you a little bit about this Proteus company and what they're doing. But in this Proteus mythological sea god, and then even along with this cartoon or this Marvel comic, he would possess the host. So he would enter in to the host, and he was a shapeshifter. He could change his shape, but he could affect the consciousness of the host. In other words, he would change their understanding of things. He would get into their mind and change things. That's what I'm trying to tell you. I believe something's going to happen to people's minds during this time frame. It says right here that Proteus was a mutant that possesses, and it says he possessed vast psionic, P-S-I-O-N-I-C, ability. I had to look that word up. It wasn't even in my dictionary. I had to Google it. And basically the idea is it's a cult power. It's a cult power that has to do a lot with telepathy. You know, and we're going to talk a little bit about that tonight. You know what telepathy is, huh? Telepathy is, according to this, is whenever they can interject thoughts into your mind. Or they can read your mind. There's a communication that takes place, whether you believe in telepathy or not. I'm just trying to tell you the definition of it. That the concept of mental telepathy is that I can look at you and I can get your thoughts out of your head. Now I'm not talking about operating in the gift of the Spirit. That's a whole different story. When you're operating the gift of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit gives you wisdom to understand what's going on in certain circumstances. I'm talking about in the occult world. They're able to. How do they do this? It's all through demon spirits. Does it freak you out to know that the enemy has power? Did you not read the Bible whenever Pharaoh's magicians threw the rod down, the staff down, and they turned it to a serpent? Did you forget that? Did you forget in the book of Revelation that the Antichrist, they're going to call fire down from heaven? It shouldn't blow you away that much that the enemy of your soul has power. And so anyway, he has psionic ability. He can, this Proteus, he can read minds, but not only that, he can interject thoughts in people's minds. And he can manipulate and alter reality. And it goes on to say, once again, that he would possess, and once again, he had telepathic and manipulation powers. So this is the company Proteus I wanted to tell you about, Proteus Digital Health. See, I don't think it's an accident that they chose that name, me personally. You'll never get me to believe that. You might believe that. The people that work for Proteus might believe that, but I don't believe it. There's thousands of companies right now that are working on technology like this. This is a digital pill. It's actually been passed by the FDA. You can get this pill right here. And what this pill does is that it's electronic, and you can take up to 30 of these pills a day. And what you do is when you take the pill, there's some other devices, and it records various information about the word we use in medicine, or it has to do with the homeostasis of the body, or the how the body is doing at that point in time. It can monitor glucose levels. It can monitor, your heart rate from the inside. It can monitor all this information. And the whole point to one of the things that I read was that it's no longer going to be a world where the patient has control of their health care. But now the doctor is going to say, take your pill and let's see how compliant you've been. So you take the pill, and now they can tell you haven't been taking your medicines. You understand? And so now you've become part of an electronic machine. Cynthia, don't be thinking about giving my mom one of them pills. Anyway, no, I'm just being silly. But you understand what's going on. So we're going to just kind of move forward. And this is the story of whenever Proteus got their FDA approval. Redwood City, California, was it back in 2012. Proteus Digital Health, Inc. announced today that the U.S. Food and Drug Administration has cleared its ingestible sensor for marketing as a medical device. The ingestible sensor, formerly referred to as the ingestion event marker, is part of the Proteus Digital Health Feedback System, an integrated end-to-end personal health management system that is designed to help improve patients' health habits and connections to caregivers. I cut it off before the part where it says they're going to take the ability of the patient to take care of their own health care. But you see what's going on there. This is just another FDA approval. Computer chip for humans. Mm-hmm. This one here says, medical milestone or privacy invasion. A tiny computer chip approved Wednesday for implantation in a patient's arm can speed vital information about a patient's medical history to doctors and hospitals, but critics warn that it could open new ways to impede the confidentiality, to imperil the confidentiality of medical records. The Food and Drug Administration said Wednesday that Applied Digital Solutions of Delray Beach, Florida, could market the web chip, an implantable computer chip about the size of a grain of rice, for medical purposes. With the pinch of a syringe, the microchip is inserted under the skin in a procedure that takes less than 20 minutes and leaves no stitches. Silently and invisibly, the document chip stores a code that releases patient-specific information when a scanner passes over it. It's been, these things have been approved by the FDA. The microchip, that's about what it looks like right there, the size of it, and then it's implanted under your skin, and it can be scanned. All right, now, so I want you to see here that there's a, I wanted to point out to you that there's a union between these two companies. Actually, this was interesting to me. Google owns Motorola, which I didn't know. Google owns Motorola, and there's a division in Motorola that has advanced research. Okay, so I'm about to introduce you to a woman. And come to find out, Motorola and Proteus have gotten together. And this woman here, her name's Regina Dugan. So what I wanted you to see once again is that Regina Dugan has come together. She works for Motorola, the division of Google, which handles this high-level research for Motorola. And Motorola and Proteus have come together, and she's kind of spearheading all of this. And what Regina Dugan used to work for, a place called DARPA. It's hard for you to see it, but basically what it says right here is that DARPA is the Department of Advanced Research and Projects, okay, for the United States of America. And they do advanced research in various types of weaponry or technological advances. And look at what this, I got this off of their site, okay? It says, DARPA explicitly reaches for transformational change instead of incremental advances. So to some extent, they got to take, I'm talking about if there's, what are we talking about? We're talking about government takeover. And now you're talking about the United States of America. Be careful, preacher. I'm talking about any government. Do you know what the Word of God says? The Word of God says that it's all working towards a one world order. Do you think that America is going to be the one to stand in the way and to stop the whole thing? I hate to tell you, I'm going to show you some other stuff. You may not even come back after tonight. It's not like I'm trying to run you off. I didn't even purposely try to find out all this information. It just happened. As the Lord pushed me in a certain direction and I started having my eyes open, I'm like, no, not that, Lord. Tell me that can't be true. Oh, yes. Yes, son. It's true. It's sad, but it's true. And so, anyway, I wanted you to know that it's not incremental change, but transformational change. Look what it says. It performs its engineering alchemy. That may not even mean anything to you, but I can't tell you how long I studied what the concept of alchemy was. It's black magic. Alchemy is black magic. Transmuters of metals. Yes, it's where modern-day chemistry comes from. But the science of alchemy has to do with machines. Frankenstein, that story about the creation of that monster, all that has to do with alchemy. Mixture of electricity along with, and using technology in order for the purposes of occult power, all that stuff integrated with technology and the occult powers is called alchemy. And listen, I could sit here and tell you, quote, you know, that there's people that wrote books, black magic practitioners that wrote books on alchemy. And so you can't separate it. It is what it is. It's documented. And these people have it on their website. They admit it. And so Regina Dugan used to be, the reason I'm telling you about DARPA is the woman I introduced you to. She used to be in charge of DARPA. Now she's in charge of the Motorola thing. So she's going from a government position to this Motorola position. Okay? It says, performs its alchemy in isolation. It works within an innovation ecosystem that includes academic, corporate, and governmental partners with a constant focus on the nation's military services, which work with DARPA to create new strategic opportunities and move tactical options. All right. Now, this is a place called HARP, which comes under DARPA's umbrella. HARP is in Alaska, and the story on HARP is, now, you know, look, if you do any cross-referencing on any of this, then you have a lot of people that tell you that people like me are crazy because that's not really what's going on over here. okay? So there's always an alternate version of the story. Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, HAARP is run by the United States government, and it falls under the umbrella of DARPA, has a big part to it. And basically what's happening is that it stands, it has something to do with the auroral project. I'll show you in a second. But these they're conductors of some sort, actually put electromagnetic ions into the atmosphere, and they say that they can control weather with this thing. They can cause weather to be changed. But not only that, they can send electromagnetical impulses into the atmosphere. And we're going to talk a little bit more about electromagnetic impulses here in a moment, but it can begin to affect the way you think. It can begin to affect your person. It can suggest thoughts in your mind, according to other information that I'll show you. So basically, HAARP stands for the High Frequency Active Auroral Research Program. And so this is just basically telling you that it's part of the defense of the United States of America, and it's under the umbrella of the U.S. Navy, the University of Alaska, and also DARPA, which I had just introduced you to. Once again, we're talking about Regina Dugan, okay? And I did all that just to show you. I just wanted to show you that in this combination, this is what she said. You can't read the top. Sorry about that. It says, passwords are clumsy, and most people won't use them. What might be better? Passwords that emanate out of you. So Regina Dugan, Motorola, Proteus, we come together, and actually they got a form of what they're calling it, a tattoo that you can put on your skin, or you swallow these pills. And now you become interactive with your device. See what it says at the bottom, electronics are boxy and rigid, humans are curvy and soft. Dugan said, by partnering with other companies, we can make authentication more human, or we can make humans, I would say, more like electronic cyborgs. But nevertheless, when they're talking about authentication, they want to know that you really are who you say you are. So now you don't have to worry about a password, so you're worried about somebody reading your text message. Well, no, they're talking about people stealing people's identity. And they're talking, now there's no question, you don't have to have a password because you become one with the device. As a matter of fact, whenever you come up to the device, if you got your little tattoo skin thing on and you're connected to it, this whole, it turns, when you come into range, I got like these little earbud things I stick in my, and if I walk out, if I'm talking to somebody, I leave my phone in the car. If I'm ever talking to you and you hear me go back and open up the door and close it again, it's because I forgot my phone in the car. And whenever I get ready to get in the store, you're starting to get staticky. And I realize, oh, I left my phone in the car. I got to go back and get my phone. But this what they're talking about is that you become one with the electronic device. The one person that I saw talking about it is that they have technology now that literally, if you had these pills in you or you had this device upon you, that when you walked in, everything, you start becoming one with your whole environment that's around you. You start grabbing groceries off the shelf, and you don't even have to go to the cash register because you've been authenticated. Like, they know who you are, they know what your bank account is, they know every single item that you walked out of the store with, and the transaction's just taking place as fast as you can even wrap your mind around it. No man's going to be able to buy or sell without a mark on his right hand or in his forehead. And that's what's happening. You know, that's the whole work towards this. They can tell us that it's about a password, but all this technology, I believe, has something to do with making it to where we are become slaves, or whoever's here becomes slaves to this system. And then, listen, you're pretty tough for Jesus right now, but wait till your belly's hungry. Wait till your baby's hungry. Just saying. So anyway, that's what Regina Dugan's up to. And all the stuff that she used to be doing. So there's just an example of the little tattoo thing that they have that would take the place of the pill. You know, could you imagine putting something in, ingesting a pill, an electronic device into your body, or having somebody? I mean, what in the world? I mean, now you have an electronic device in your hand or your forehead. I mean, God only knows what they can be transmitting to you. Anyway, that kind of brings me to my next thought. You can't see this picture too good. Can y'all see that guy's eyebrows? Yeah. Isn't that some? His name's Lieutenant Michael Aquino, A-Q-U-I-N-O. He's a Satanist. He was a high-ranking military. He's not ashamed to let you know he's a Satanist. Look at his eyebrows. Everybody knew he was a Satanist. He actually left Anton LaVey. That's him. He started this thing called Temple of Set. And he used to be with Anton LaVey right here. You know who that is. I know Sammy Davis Jr. He was a well-known Satanist too, by the way. They hide that stuff kind of good. But the fact of the matter is, you ever heard of Jane Mansfield? Because I didn't have a picture of her. But they got pictures of Jane Mansfield on her knees drinking out of a cup out of his hand. So this is Anton LaVey, and he was the church. He was the leader of the Church of Satan. And this is Lieutenant Colonel Michael Aquino, who worked for special operations in the army. He was, if I'm not mistaken, he was in the Air Force. I looked at his resume one time. I studied him a long time ago. His resume was impeccable. I mean, unbelievable, the education level that this man had. Anyway, the reason that I'm bringing him up is because I'm talking about the mind, and I'm talking about them getting a hold of the mind, and I'm talking about these electronic devices, and I ran across something that he wrote. It was called, I'm not saying this is the title of the book, but the idea was we're going away from psychological operations to an actual war of the mind, okay? And so this is part of what he read, and unfortunately, I keep messing up on my little things here, but it says, these media, he's talking about ways to grab a hold of people's minds, okay? Now, he wrote this back in the 60s. These media, of course, the electronic media, television and radio, state-of-the-art developments in satellite communication, video recording techniques, and laser. He's talking about getting a hold of people's minds and talking about moving into countries. Like, this is what this paper was written for the United States of America to be able to rapidly take control of a country. And you remember in Vietnam, those pictures that you can see now of that little Vietnamese girl that didn't have any clothes on and she's running down the street? That was part of the original plan. They took pictures of all that. That was all staged. They took pictures of that and burning bodies, and they dropped it from airplanes to where people would see this stuff, and it struck fear in their hearts. And so it was a matter of working on their psychology and weakening them, all right? And so and this is a Satanist, all right? I'm just saying. I mean, this is the kind of stuff that they do. Brainwashing was that physical torture and deprivation would weaken the mind's resistance to suggestion, and this was true to a point, but in the long run, brainwashing does not work because intelligent minds later realize their suggestibility under such. In other words, if you're smart, they may do a good job of torture on you and they begin to brainwash you, but at some point you start having some recall and you start snapping out of it and you start realizing, no, they've done something to me. So it didn't really work on the smartest people, okay? It says right here, for the mind to believe in its own decisions, it must feel that it made those decisions without coercion. You get the point, what he's trying to say. So I probably tried to teach too much in one shot, but talking about mind control, this comes right here. This guy right here was a Nazi psychiatrist. He's the one that developed torture-related mind control and brainwashing. Now, if you do a study on this guy, his name's Joseph Mengele. You see his hat right here? It's like a skull and bones right there. I wanted to talk about that for a second. But you know, he, according to the way the story goes, he actually, after World War II, worked with the CIA. You can't prove it, but people swear his name was Dr. Green. And he taught the CIA torture techniques that whenever they would torture somebody bad enough, it would cause them to separate in their personality, and they would be able to brainwash them into doing various things and to believe certain things through torture. Now, you remember what Michael Aquino was saying, is that some of these techniques didn't really work as well in some of the more intelligent people, so they've been working on other things since then. That was him too. And so, you know, as far as Nazis go, I just thought it was interesting to point out the skull and bones. That was actually what was on his hat. You couldn't see it that well. You know, that's a very prominent occult symbol. I won't get into what I think about what that whole Nazi Germany thing is right now. But later on, I think I'm going to do a teaching on the occult exposure. Now, I hate to break the bad news to you, but this is the skull and bones. And you see it's the same emblem here that's right there. And they say that this is Geronimo's skull. This is a secret society called Skull and Bones that's at Yale University, the most prominent and wealthy people, the most up and coming of society can only be in this club. And that's George Bush right there. Now, he admits he was in this thing. That's senior. He admits he was in this thing, and so does junior. They've admitted it on TV before. Now, and if you do any research on this, they do ceremonies where they're enacting human sacrifice. And I'm not saying that they're doing human sacrifice right there, that that's what they actually caught. But there's people have caught them on audio and video doing rituals that have to do with human sacrifice. All right? And so here's another thing with the skull. I'm just trying to tell you that I believe that there's a connection between Nazi Germany and the occult. And I think that it was much bigger than what we realize, and that all of this occultic type stuff is all really in unison, and that they're all being led by the enemy. And I don't think it's as separated as what we think. That's just my personal opinion. You may not be catching on completely to what I'm trying to say, but I think that there's a lot of people that are in this together that are working against, and that's why it's called secret societies, and that's why we don't really know about it, all right? But anyway, going back to Michael Aquino, look what he's talking about, electromagnetics. He says extremely low frequency waves. Actually, HARP transmits some of those exact waves. It says the human body communicates internally by these electromagnetic or chemical impulses, and the field may be displayed. It says in the body's physical responses to various types of these things. Okay, so the body responds to this. It says under varying external conditions, humans are more or less disposed to the consideration of new ideas. All right, I wanted to read this to you real quick. I got to move on. It says right here, and this was from a UK-based newspaper. That's what it says. It's called the Daily Mail. It says right here that research in electromagnetic weapons had been secretly carried out in the United States and Russia since the 1950s, and that previous research has shown that low-frequency waves or beams can affect brain cells, alter psychological states, and make it possible to transmit suggestions and commands directly into someone's thought processes. Listen, I did more research, and there's literally pieces of equipment that can send sound waves out, and then they're received inside the brain. You don't even hear it through your ear, and it's as though you're actually hearing it on the inside of your brain. Have you ever heard a word from the Lord before? The only hope, the only thing I can tell you is that the only difference that I know when I hear a word from the Lord is that it's coming from my belly. It's coming from my belly up into my head. But there's a difference between it. It's not just a thought that comes from mad. It's coming from deeper within. Amen? And so, but anyway, look, they can do some crazy stuff. Suggestions and commands directly into someone's thought processes. High dose of microwaves can damage the functioning of internal organs, okay? And even cause people to think about suicide. So I'm really near the end, and I'm just reminding you that I talked to you about authentication, identification, and that, you know what, they're going to want people to come together and to receive. This is like the new tattoo. It's implantable. So it's getting society ready. Right? It's cool, man. It's groovy. You get your new little implantable tattoo or whatever. And this right here is going to be an LED tattoo, man. You stick this under there. It's like got silicone electronics, and it glows in the dark. And so, you know, I thought that this was interesting. They're calling it medical, this whole thing, because of the electronic devices and all this other kind of stuff going on. So basically what I was trying to say is, and I wanted to close this up because I think that I went a little longer than I planned on it. But what I wanted to do was, I just wanted to say to you that I personally think that something strange is going to happen to the human that takes this mark. I'm not saying that it is all this, that it's electromagnetics that are being transmitted from Alaska or whatever the case, but I do believe that, I don't know about you, but it's kind of freaky to me to know all of the different things that they can do through these electronic devices, and that people are going to actually be implanting something into their skin. And there's no doubt in my mind that they couldn't take over a person's mind if somebody actually went this way and actually caused their consciousness to change, their thought processes on God to change, to the point where they could never repent, to the point where they would become so seared towards the things of God that there was no hope in ever turning back. I don't know if you would agree with that or not.